And welcome back, Algebra 2B. And we're going to finish up some of our notes from the last little bit here. This time we're going to be rationalizing the denominator, if you recall doing that before. So we're just going to be adding on to it for things like cubic roots and so forth. Just remember, rationalizing the denominator, things that we do not like in mathematics are, we call them rats in the denominator. No rats or rads in the denominator, okay? Just does not look right. So what you do in order to get rid of those is you multiply by the same radical that is in the denominator over itself. Really, all that is a fancy way to say the number one, okay? When you do that, some magic happens. You end up with square root of 21 all over, in this case, square root of 9, which is really square root of 21 all over 3. At that point, the rat is gone, and we're happy, and that's all that you need to do. Another one that you may come across is maybe you just have like something like 2 roots of 6, in which case, again, you would multiply by the root of 6 all over the root of 6, just the square root part. Again, that's just a funky way to say 1. And from there, you would have 2 roots of 6 all over the root of 36, which is 2 roots of 6 all over 6. Hey, that can actually simplify more. 2 and 6 can just become root of 6 all over 3. So a nice little thing that happens with that. And the last one to really remember here is something like 2 roots of 5 all over, actually, sorry. 2 over root of 5, getting ahead of myself, you would multiply by the root of 5 all over the root of 5, and in that case, get 2 roots of 5 all over root of 25, and in this case, it just doesn't simplify more, but you're left with something a little bit different. So, radicals, it's called rationalizing. We are making the bottom number, the denominator, a rational number, by getting rid of the square root. So some new stuff. Key is to look at the index and see how many of something, we're not quite sure what, that you need. For example, if we were to take the 4th root of 10 all over the 4th root of 27, okay, what we can do is think about that as the 4th root. So let's take a look at what the 4th root of 27 is. This is really 3 to the 3rd power. Okay, so it's just going to look a little bit different for right now. In order to then simplify this, so it's 3 to the 3rd power. Okay, and just bear with me here. We are going to multiply by the cubic root of 3. Okay, so we're going to multiply by the fourth root, sorry, of 3. So let's just think of instead of the 27, let's just think of it as 4 roots of 3 to the 3rd. Okay, so what we are then multiplying by is the 4th root and try and simplify the bottom of 3. So 4 over root of 3 times 4 over root of 3. Now the whole idea of that is because then this is going to become equal to the 4th root of 30 all over the 4th root of, if we think of this here, so if this is 3 to the 3rd, by multiplying it by another 3, we have the 4th root of 3 to the 4th. So in a sense, we needed another 3 here, and in which case you end up with 4 roots of 30 all over 4, and the 3 to the 4th cancel all over 3. Okay, it takes a little bit of practice, especially to get these ones done. Let's look at another example. 5th root of 7 all over the 5th root of 8. Okay, First, let's take a look at 8. We know that it is a perfect cube, actually, so we can write it as 5th root of 7 all over 5th root of 2 to the 3rd. Okay, now we want this number and this number to be the same. Okay, so that means we would actually want to multiply by a 2 squared, so a 5th root of 2 squared. Because when we multiply, we'll add those. All over 5th root of 2 squared. Okay, let's check to see what happens here. Okay, then we get the 5th root of 7 times 4, essentially, is 28. Okay, and then we have the 5th root of 2 to the 5th. Some magic happens. We have the 5th root of 28 all over 2. And that's what that comes out to be. More example, let's take the 4th root of 20 and divide that by 3 times the 4th root of 250. We can start by making this easier on ourselves. Divide everything by 10, essentially, and we have the 4th root of 2 divided by 3 times the 4th root of 25. 25 we can recognize as 5 squared. So let's just rewrite it as that right now. 4th root of 2 all over 3 times 4th root of 5 squared. Okay, we want this squared to become a 4. So we're going to multiply by the 4th root of 5 squared again. Okay, in the numerator we have the 4th root then of 25 times 2 would be 50. And then we have 3 times the 4th root of 5 to the 4th. Magic happens, those would cancel, the root would disappear. So we have 4 roots of 50 all over 3 times 5, essentially, which is 4 roots of 50 all over 15. Okay, so that's what that would become. Simplifying radical expressions involving variables. Okay, this one, so not rationalizing, but just kind of switching gears and thinking here, we have 5th root of, let's say, 32x to the 15th. Okay, first let's think of the 32, how to break that up. So the 5th root of 32 is 5th root of 2 to the 5th. Okay, and then if we think of 15, let's think of it in terms of 5s. Okay, so essentially we're going to think of it as x to the 5th times x to the 5th times x to the 5th. Okay, in which case all of these would essentially come outside of the radical. So you can have, so this 5 and this 5 will cancel, and then 2 would come out. 5 and the x, x, 5 and the x, x, 5 and the last x, x, which would be 2x to the 3rd. Some more practice problems will definitely help us out for these. How about the 5th root of square root of 4, x to the 10th, y to the 15th, and z to the 5th? Another way I like to think about this, well, one, we can't take the 5th root of 4, so it's going to stay inside there. What you can really do is divide each of the ones inside by the 5, and that tells you how many come outside. So you have x squared. 10 divided by 5 is 2. We also would have a y to the 15th. 15 divided by 5 is 3. And then 5 divided by 5 is 1. So x squared, y to the 3rd, z, 5th root of 4 is your answer for that one. The big square root. Make sure that when you're writing these, you distinguish what is a radical and what's not. Another example, let's take the cubic root of 64, y to the sixth. 64, you want to think of perfect cubes that go into 64. It is really the same thing as 2 to the third, 8 times another 2 to the third. Okay, 64 is a perfect cube of 4. So the cubic root of 64 is just 4. And as for the y's, divide by 3, you would have y squared. Okay, where it gets a little more challenging, perhaps, are things like the fourth root of x to the fourth all over y to the eighth. Okay, again, we can split it up into two little radicals, four roots x to the fourth all over fourth root y to the eighth. Let's think, 4 divided by 4 is 1, so x, 8 divided by 4 is 2 over y squared. Another example, fourth root of 32, x to the 10th, y to the 7th, and z to the 12th. Okay, so let's think here, 32, perfect cubes go to 32, fourths at least. It's the same thing as 16 times 2. So the fourth root of 16 times the fourth root of 2. Fourth root of 16 is just 2. So that's just going to become a 2, and we'd be left with a 2 outside. Now, for the variables, 10 and 4. So 10 is not divisible by 4. What you can also think of it as is if you would divide, it's squared and you'd have 2 left over. Okay, remember dividing by things before and having a remainder. So it's like 10 divided by 4, remainder of 2. 7, how many times does 4 go into 7? It goes into it once and you'd have 3 left over. And 4 going into 12, 4 goes into 12 three times, so you wouldn't have any leftovers for that one. Example here, 3 roots of 16, x to the 9th, y to the 12th, z to the 11th. So 2 to the 3rd is 8 times 2, and then 2 to the 3rd is just going to become 2 outside, leave you with a root of 2 inside. 9 and 3, so you'd have 3 x's. 12 and 3, you'd have 4 y's. And 11 divided by 3 is z to the 3rd. And this index should also be on both of these. Sorry. 3 goes into 11 three times with a remainder of 2. So cubic root 2z squared. Again, they will likely take you a lot of practice. Last thing I want to just cover, I know it's been quite a lot at you all here at once, but just to get through these, simplifying expressions with fractional exponents and variables. Okay. For example, if we have 36m n to the 10th, all to the 1 half. What you can do is this 1 half, rewrite it as a square root. So it's a square root of 36 m n to the 10th. Okay, you don't need to write a 2 there. You can, it's no big deal. So really you're just taking the square root of 36, which is 6. Square root of m you cannot take because it's just an m. And n to the 10th would be n to the 5th. Okay. Another example, let's say 27 x to the 3rd, y to the 10th, all to the 1 3rd. I would rewrite it as the cubic root of 27 x to the 3rd, y to the 10th. Cubic root of 27 is 3. Okay. Cubic root of x to the 3rd, 3 divided by 3 is 1, and 10 divided by 3 3 goes into 10 three times, but you have a remainder of 1 left over. And the grand finale here, 42. X to the 4th, Y to the 7th, all over 6X to the 3 halves, Y to the negative 3, Z to the 5th. What? Let's zoom in on this one. Okay, let's take it step by step. First, let's worry about 42 divided by 6. That is 7. Okay, when you have variables in the numerator and the denominator, you subtract them. So 4 minus 3 halves for the exponents of the x's is really x to the 5 halves. Okay, positive. Now same with the 7. So 7 minus negative 3 for the y's is y to the 10th, and then that's going to be all over z to the 5th. Okay, so let's just kind of check out some things here. Really the only thing that will change, so to speak, is this x to the 5 halves is throwing things off. We don't like to have fractional exponents. So we'll just rewrite this as 7y to the 10th, and then rewrite our 5 halves as square root of x to the 5th, all over z to the 5th. And the last thing that can happen, okay, the x to the 5th, let's just break it down. How many pairs of x can come out? 5 divided by 2 is 2, so x squared, we're left over with an x all over z to the 5th. That is the grand finale of problems. Okay, thanks for getting those completed, and work on some of the practice problems that you have. Thanks.